I'm speaking with Dr. Yuval Steinitz. He is a member of the Israeli Knesset from the Likud party and one of the top-ranking members of the Likud. He's also a former chairman of the Knesset Foreign Affairs and Defense Committee. He used to be active in the Peace Now movement, but says he moved to the right when he saw the negative results of the Oslo Agreement. In addition to his political work, Dr. Steinitz has also taught philosophy of science and philosophy of metaphysics at the University of Haifa. Dr. Steinitz, what exactly made you decide to leave Peace Now?
Oh, I did support the effort to achieve peaceful coexistence and peace agreement vis-a-vis the Palestinians when I thought that this is possible, and I was ready to make concessions for it. But in the middle of the 90s, I realized that this is not peace process, unfortunately, but more likely it is becoming war process. That the formula of land for peace, which I advocated, is becoming land for war, land for terrorism, land for incitement.
So you're opposed to the land for peace process in general right now?
No, but right now there are no conditions, no reliable partners. On the contrary, right now it's clear that the so-called peace process brought us more agony and suffering and fighting and animosity than before. And this is not a genuine peace process. By the way, the Palestinians are also suffering, but I do care about Israel and Israelis and about our national security.
So do you think there's anything likely to change that will create a viable peace partner, or is this simply a clash of two incompatible peoples in which there's going to be a winner and a loser, as opposed to a win-win situation?
Yes, well, I don't know if it is zero-sum game, but one thing is clear. It is today a part of the clash of civilization that do exist between fundamentalism, Islamic fundamentalism, and the free world, and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict became part of this more general clash. Therefore, it's very difficult to resolve. And I tell you honestly, you know, I once, as Peace Now member, we had the slogan. The slogan was about coexistence. Two states for two people. One is an Arab-Palestinian state, and the other is a Jewish-Israeli state for the Jewish people, homeland for the Jewish people. It became evident now that according to most Palestinians, it's two states for the Palestinian people. Even Abu Mazen, you know, we are putting so much emphasis about the Hamas, the so-called bad guys, but even Abu Mazen is speaking about the right of return of Palestinians, not to the Palestinian state, so but into the Jewish state.
So they're not really willing to accept a Jewish state of any size or shape, is that correct?
Yes, I would put it like this. It became clear, as frustrating as it is, well, that the main aim of most Palestinians is not to establish a homeland for the Palestinian people. This is not the first priority, but to destroy it, or at least to harm the Jewish homeland.
So what do you think Israel should do in this case?
Well, I think that last year we did almost all the possible mistakes vis-a-vis the Palestinians, vis-a-vis the Hamas. Look, if you compare our situation to 1 year ago, Hamas became stronger and stronger politically, diplomatically, also militarily, and we are sitting and doing nothing. I mean, we explain the world as those are terrorists.
What do you think is
But it doesn't work. And it is not convincing because we don't treat them as terrorists. And unlike in philosophy, unlike in a theoretical reasoning, in the real political life, one thing is clear to me. You can explain, our Prime Minister Ehud Olmert and Foreign Minister Tzipi Livni can explain the world from morning till evening that Hamas guys are terrible fundamentalist terrorists. If this is inconsistent with our behavior, with our treatment of the Hamas, and last year it was totally inconsistent, it won't convince the world. If they're terrorists, we should treat them like the United States is treating Al-Qaeda, like we treated them 2 years ago when we killed Sheikh Ahmad Yassin, their leaders, and Rantisi, his replacement, his deputy, and many other leaders, and we arrested many other leaders. Last year, we treated them differently. We enabled them to participate in the elections, although it's totally inconsistent with previous agreements. You know, previous agreements, in the Oslo agreement, there is a clear paragraph that only organizations or parties that do recognize Israel's right to exist can participate in the Palestinian elections.
Now, why did Israel do all this? Is there something that the Israeli government didn't understand, or is there some other motive behind it? I mean, Israel must know that Hamas wants to destroy it. Why does it give it such...
It's really difficult to say. But I can see clear change since Ehud Olmert replaced Sharon, since Sharon became sick and Ehud Olmert took his seat. It's difficult me to predict what Sharon was exactly doing in each case, but look, 2 years ago, Sharon told us and convinced us that even Abu Mazen is not a reliable partner because he's totally unable of delivering. And therefore, we took unilateral steps in Gaza because Abu Mazen was not a reliable partner in Sharon's eyes. He said it is useless to reach any agreement with Abu Mazen because he is totally incapable of delivering. Now, we have been told by the Olmert government that Abu Mazen is reliable, almost desirable partner. I don't know what changed. And even even Hamas government, you know, they are trying to make totally irrational. It's actually the state of Israel that I'm criticizing now. What we are trying to do is totally irrational. First, we are trying to convince the world that those are terrorists, but we don't treat them as terrorists. We don't treat them as we treated them in the past, as the United States is treating Al-Qaeda and their leadership. And secondly, even more odd, we are trying to make impossible distinction between the president, Mahmoud Abbas, Abu Mazen, and his government. He established the government. He signed on the guidelines. So we're saying the government guidelines are unacceptable, so we are not speaking with the government. This is a terrorist government. But we shall speak and negotiate with the president that established this very government.
Was Israel trying to use Abu Mazen as maybe a counterweight to Hamas?
Yes, but you know, it's totally illogical and irrational. He established the Hamas government. And you know, it will be something like, for example, to say that we won't speak with the White House, that somebody will boycott the White House and President Bush, but will speak with one of his ministers, with, for example, the defense minister of the United States, saying that this is a different branch. This is ridiculous. There is one Palestinian government, there is one Palestinian regime, and you cannot separate. They want us to separate. No, Hamas asks us to separate. Hamas, Ismail Haniyeh, the Palestinian prime minister, is telling us, I don't want to speak with you. My government will not recognize even your right to exist as a Jewish state. Jews have no place in the Middle East, no place in the Eretz Israel, in the land of Israel. There is no place for Jewish homeland. We don't recognize you. We will even continue to sponsor and to support terrorism against you.
Well, they're shooting, but
we ask you, we don't want to speak with you. We send you Abu Mazen, speak with him. We like you to speak with him. And what's the reaction of the state of Israel? Okay, you want us to separate between your government that doesn't recognize us and to negotiate with your president? Let's do it.
There seems to be a major crisis of confidence in the Israeli government right now. This is the most unpopular government in Israel's history. Most people don't believe it can protect the people of Israel. Does it look like the government may be forced to resign and new elections held?
I think most Israelis hope so. Look, these Kadima governments, Olmert governments, failed twice on two different fronts in less than 1 year. First, it failed against the Hamas. Hamas took power. Hamas became stronger. Hamas is building now a really terrorist army in Gaza with a lot of weapons. They are training thousands of people. We are doing nothing to prevent it.
What's the thinking behind doing nothing?
And let me just finish. And vis-a-vis the Hezbollah in the north. You know, last summer, we missed a golden opportunity to eliminate the Hezbollah military presence in South Lebanon and to gain clear victory over this Iranian arm that is threatening the north of Israel. The world supported us, not just the United States. Europe supported us. France supported us. We missed this opportunity. And people are extremely frustrated in Israel and asking themselves, if this weak government that failed to protect the people in the north in Israel against missiles coming from Lebanon for 4 weeks, and that is failing to protect the people of Shderot, more than 2,000 rockets, Qassam rockets, were fired from Gaza to Shderot in the last year. How this weak government will be able to do the right things vis-a-vis the stronger Arab states like Syria or Egypt, or all the more so vis-a-vis the Iranian missiles.
Now, who could replace the current government? Do you think Netanyahu might get another chance to be prime minister?
I think so. I think that Netanyahu was a good prime minister in the 90s, especially all the more so in comparison to the current government. I think he was excellent, the best finance minister in Israel history. And I believe that together we can create much more reliable and much stronger governments than the current one.
Now, there must be some kind of reasoning or some kind of philosophy behind why the current government is willing to accept daily rocket and missile attacks and not respond. I mean, it doesn't seem like it could be simply irrational. They must be thinking of something. You're a philosopher, philosophy professor. What's the thinking behind, well, we'll just let them keep hitting us and we won't do anything?
I don't know. You know, there are the excuses that if we are doing nothing and we are suffering all the time, maybe the world supports us. Yes, because they will appreciate our restraint, our moderation.
But why would the world support someone who won't support himself?
That's exactly, I think it's exactly the opposite. The world will not support those who do not support themselves. The world will not accept our claim that those are terrorists until we will treat them as terrorists. You know, it was excellent test what happened with Arafat. When the second intifada started in 2000, yes, in the year 2000, and Sharon replaced Ehud Barak as prime minister, Sharon was trying to convince the world that Arafat is terrorist or a terrorist supporting leader. In the first 2 years, nobody listened. We said Arafat, despite the fact that he is democratically elected president of the Palestinian people and a Nobel laureate for peace, strange as it is, we were trying to tell the world these facts. He's sponsoring terrorism. In English, he's speaking against terrorism. In Arabic, he supports terrorism. He is sending money to terrorists. And so, nothing changed. And then, after 2 years, Sharon began to take some steps against Arafat. First, we cut all ties, government ties with Arafat and his people. Then, a few months later, we put Arafat under blockade in Ramallah. We didn't let him out of Ramallah. Then, after another half a year, we closed him in his offices in the Mukata. You remember, he was under siege in the last 2 years of his life. And then, only then, the world began to accept our claim that this is a terrorist-supporting leader. And step by step, first in America and then in Europe, people began to say, Arafat is not the solution, he is not a reliable partner, we shouldn't speak with him, we shouldn't support him, we shouldn't send him money anymore. What happened? The verbal explanation, whereas before. But the moment we treated him as terrorist supporting leader, it took some time. But the world realized that this might be the case.
So he's saying that Israel should fight terrorism instead of just complaining about it and hoping that somebody else will fight it.
The worst tactic on the battlefield and on the propaganda, on the public relations, is not to fight terrorism. If you fight, if you take action, I mean, if it's rational, I mean, if it's reasonable, if it's totally irrational, nobody will accept it. But if it is rational, if it is in the context, this is the best public relations, to take action.
Well, speaking about public relations, I'm glad you brought that up, because as far as I can tell, Israel's public relations are terrible. I listen to their pronouncements, and I can't figure out what their message is. And what is Israel's message to the world, if they have one?
Well, I must tell you, currently, it is not clear to me either. I cannot say.
Now, if
you know, we are trying to tell the world such and all things, and every minister is having his own policy and all his own public relations, you know, his own peace plan. There is one peace plan of Ehud Olmert, another inconsistent peace plan of Tzipi Livni, you know. They disagree between them, another with another deputy, Shimon Peres, build a completely different peace plan, and also Amir Peres. You have four different government peace plans. All of them are ridiculous because there is no partner.
But there are no war plans. Everyone is planning for peace, but it takes two sides to make peace and only one side to keep the war going.
Yes, I completely agree with you.
So in America, we call that being in a state of denial. Would you say that?
It's not just war plans. There are some war plans, okay, but we are not doing the right things. Take last summer war in Lebanon, for example. As I mentioned before, we missed a golden opportunity here. What did happen there? From technical point of view, from purely military point of view, we can claim that we were victorious. We killed much more Hezbollah fighters than they killed IDF fighters. We destroyed Hezbollah headquarters, training bases all over Lebanon, mainly by our air force. So technically speaking, we can say we are victorious. But we lost the war. Why? Because we failed to understand two things, or to accomplish two things. First, we failed to protect our people, not just in the border zone, but in Haifa, in the Haifa Bay. 2 million Israelis were 4 weeks in underground shelters, and the mighty IDF failed to protect them, not because he was incapable, but because he didn't get the right orders from the government. And secondly, and it's two sides of the same coin, we failed to eliminate the Hezbollah military presence in South Lebanon and to gain a real victory despite the support of the world. So people, the Israelis, got out of the shelters after 1 month, and they saw no significant achievement. And as Shimon Peres admitted in the Vinograd Committee, it harmed the economy. The third of Israel was paralyzed for almost 1 month, for more than 1 month actually, and even more so, it's harmed our deterrence capacity, because it was the first case since 1948 that Israel center, not just the border zone, not just Kiryat Shmona, it's bad enough that they were shooting on Kiryat Shmona and Ari in the past, but this time 2 million Israelis were under daily rocket attack, and the government was so hesitant and so clumsy and so cautious not to send the IDF into Lebanon to stop it, that we lost the war.
Did the government have any clear goals in the war in Lebanon? It was hard to tell what they were trying to achieve.
Well, they say it. It's the beginning of the war, and we supported it. That this time, since we suffered from such terrible provocation, we are going to eradicate the missile threat, the Hezbollah missile and military threat on the north of Israel. They said so, but they were so hesitant to send the IDF deep into Lebanon that they failed to reach the mission. And by the way, I can tell you that as the chairman of the Defense and Foreign Affairs Committee, when I became the chairman in 2003, I ordered the IDF to come to our subcommittees, to our confidential subcommittees, subcommittee on intelligence and subcommittee on defense readiness, and to show the plans in case of conflagration in Lebanon. And at the beginning of 2004, we sent a secret emergency warning letter to Sharon and then Prime Minister Ariel Sharon and then Defense Minister Shaul Mofaz, warning them that if in case of conflagration in the north, Hezbollah will be shooting rockets on as far as Haifa or Hadera, which we expected, without a rapid ground operation south of Lebanon, we are going to lose the war. And we were very skeptic about the IDF doctrine of aerial victory, about the notion that we can almost occupy Lebanon from the air to such an extent that there will be no rocket launching after 1 week or so. And we sent this letter, it was a secret letter, and now my predecessor, Tzachi Hanegvi, exposed it. He found it in the files, and he exposed it. I mean, exposed part of it. Some details are still highly confidential, but it's to do with intelligence and some technologies. But we warned the IDF and the government already at February 2004 in an official warning letter, confidential then, now most of it was exposed to the media by my predecessor, that without rapid ground operation in south of Lebanon, we shall lose the war. And this is exactly what happened.
Was the fact that Olmert, the Prime Minister, and Peretz, the Defense Minister, have no real military background, is that part of the problem, that they don't know how to fight a war, and yet they're the ones who are making the decisions?
No, I wouldn't say so, because clearly it was miserable leadership. But I do remember that Israel's two best defense ministers were civilians. Of course, not ignorant civilians. One was Ben-Gurion, and the other was Moshe Arends. Both Ben-Gurion and Moshe Arends had no military background. They were not generals, not even officers. But they had, they were very educated. They were very enlightened on strategical issues, military history and things like that. And they were much better defense ministers, Ben-Gurion and Moshe Arends, than all the generals. So I wouldn't run to conclusions, and I do remember that Moshe Dayan, the most decorated and hilarious figure among Israel generals always, he led us to the almost disaster of the 1973 Mehdal of Yom Kippur War. So I wouldn't say that we need generals as defense ministers or as prime ministers, because we have the counter examples of Ben-Gurion, of Moshe Arends. I would say that it should be unacceptable, it is unacceptable in my view, to take somebody with no background. You know, the problem with Amir Peretz is not that he was not a general. He's the problem is that he never served in the cabinet. He never served in the Defense and Foreign Affairs Committee in the Knesset. He never learned such things. He never read. He never wrote. He never paid any interest on military affairs or national security.
He's also a long-time adherent of Peace Now, the organization that you disassociated from.
Yes.
And Peace Now essentially opposes all military action on principle, I believe.
No, I wouldn't go so far, but I want really to leave the issue of left out and right out of it. I just want to emphasize, my view is that defense ministers should not be generals, former generals.
But don't you have to start by defining what your goals are? And once you define your goals, then you plan the strategy for achieving them.
Yes, but I was chairing the Defense and Foreign Affairs Committee for 3.5 years. There were 20 members. One-third were former generals, like Matan Vilnai, like Ehud Yatom from the IDF, from the Shin Bet, like Binyamin Ben Eliezer and others, and two-thirds were from civilian background. And I can tell you that the contribution of those who were coming from civilian background was not less than former generals. But with Amir Peretz, the problem is not that he is not a former general. The problem is that unlike Moshe Arons, for example, he had no background and no interest. He never learned, he never paid any interest on such issues.
Let me ask you another question. What are Israel's long-term goals as a society? Where would most Israelis like to be, say, 10, 20, 30 years from now? How do they envision that?
It's difficult to say. It's clear that we are facing existential threats, and therefore, in such situation, the main goal is first to overcome those threats, and if possible, to reduce them or to eliminate them. But let's go back 30 years. Okay, instead of going to the future, let's go back for 30 years, and I think it's amazing. If you go to 1977 and you compare Israel then and now, you see that despite all the animosities that we are facing in the Middle East, despite terrible terrorism, waves of terrorism, including terrorist suicide bombing terrorism, despite all the problems and despite all the mistakes that we did, Israel is growing stronger and stronger, if you are looking at it on the long term. In 1977, we were 3 million Jews. Despite terrorism and despite animosity, we managed not to keep the number, but to double the number, and today we are 6 million Jews. So demographically, we are much stronger today than in the 70s. Economically, in 1977, we were part of the developing world, of the developing countries. Today, we are part of the developed world, and we have a very strong economy, much stronger than before. Diplomatically, and most people ignore it, in 1977, we didn't have diplomatic relations with Russia, with India, with China, and with many other states. Today, we have strong diplomatic relations with those states, with India and Turkey, we have almost strategical alliance. So we have to see also the half full glass. During the years, during the decades, and despite all the problems and all the attacks, Israel is growing stronger and stronger. And this is very, very encouraging fact.
Let's talk a little bit about the demographic issue, because some of the people who advocate land for peace raise the demographic issue. They say that it's very important that Israel have a Jewish majority, so if there's any portion of Israel that has an Arab majority, that should be severed and handed over to the Arabs. Does that make any sense to you?
It depends. We have to be very careful about it. First, we have a demographic problem. Let's admit it. Until now, we did pretty well, but we have to be very careful looking to the future. Until now, the percentage of Arabs in Israel was increasing from 40% to 18 or 19%. There are still more than 80% Jews inside Israel. And we should also take into account that the Druze and the Christian Arabs are very loyal to the country. The main problem is with Muslim Arabs. And they are around 14% of the population, which is difficult, but not that difficult. And some of them are loyal, some of them are extremely hostile to the state of Israel, and we have to do something about it. But let me go to the issue. I supported the unilateral disengagement from Gaza, mainly for the demographic reasons. But we have here to be very careful. Gaza, I believe, is a special case. Gaza is extremely densely populated, much more than any other area in the West Bank, for example, or in the Golan Heights, where there is no demographic problem. And on the other hand, strategically, from strategic point of view, Gaza is less significant than Judea and Samaria or the Golan Heights. Judea and Samaria are sitting in the country center overlooking the coastal plain, the Tel Aviv area, Jerusalem. This is extremely significant.
So do you think that Israel should hold on to Judea and Samaria?
At least currently, yes, and even in case of, in case that once in the future we will face reliable Palestinian partner, and I don't see this happening yet, we will have to preserve, even in final peace agreement, very significant security zones in Judea and Samaria, especially in Western Samaria, all those hills overlooking the coastal plain and the Tel Aviv area, the Ben Gurion airport, and along the two sides of the Jerusalem corridor. But let me refer to the demographic problem. If you take the Golan Heights, for example, the Golan Heights is overlooking the Galilee and the Sea of Galilee, but in the Golan Heights, there is no demographic problem. So I did, and I still think that Gaza is a very special case. It's a low plateau on the southern, western corner of the country. Of course, you can harm us also from this plateau.
Well, they've been attacking Israel steadily. Do you think that...
But it's not like attacking Israel as the center of Israel from Judea and Samaria.
But looking at Gaza, in retrospect, in the pullout from Gaza, do you think that Israel achieved the benefit that its leaders said it would achieve?
No. No.
You think the whole thing was a mistake?
No. No. I tell you, I think that it was the right thing for Israel not to sit in Gaza, from a strategical point of view, and to separate between our attitude to Gaza and our attitude to the country center, to Judea and Samaria and the Golan Heights. I think we did it in a wrong manner. We could have done it in a much better way. First, we should preserve the Philadelphia corridor, those 9 miles in our hands, those 9 miles that separate Gaza from Egypt.
That's where all the arms are coming through,
yes,
now,
yes,
with the Egyptians.
And by the way, I, as a chairman of the Defense and Foreign Affairs Committee, I conducted a very long and bitter debate in the Knesset, and it became also a nationwide debate against this agreement with Egypt, delivering the responsibility to Egypt on the Philadelphia corridor, because I predicted that the Egyptian will not fight the smuggling, on the contrary, that smuggling will not decrease but will be increased dramatically, because, to tell you the truth, this is a true Egyptian policy to enable the arming of the Palestinian people and the Hamas against us. So it was clear to me that this agreement will not be fulfilled by Egypt, and we cannot trust the Egyptians. But actually, the Egyptians are doing to us in Gaza exactly what Syria is doing to the Americans in north of Iraq. They succeed not to succeed. Yes, they succeed not to succeed to prevent the massive supply for terrorists of arms and ammunition through their borders.
What do you see as the ultimate resolution of this conflict? Do you think that there's going to be a negotiated settlement, or Israel just has to win, and winning means claiming its historical territory? In an all-or-nothing type of situation, either the Israelis will get it all or the Arabs will get it all, but there won't be a 50-50.
Well, I don't know. It's difficult to predict. I'm confident that we can prevail. What will be the final fate of the territories of Judea and Samaria? I'm not speaking about Gaza. It's very clear to me about Gaza that we are not, at least not in any foreseeable future, we are not going back to Gaza to settle there. We should go back there to strike terrorist networks and terrorist infrastructure. And this is becoming very urgent, but not to recapture Gaza permanently. With Judea and Samaria, I think that we have to wait and see. And meanwhile, we could choose a different strategy that will improve our situation also in Judea and Samaria. With the Golan Heights, it's very clear. In my view, at least, we shouldn't compromise on the Golan Heights. This should remain Israeli.
Just keep it. Period.
Just keep it. It's part of the state of Israel. It's part of our history. It's essential to our security. It is meaningless to Syria. It's not important at all to Syria, just as an excuse to continue the
But it's an elevated place, conflict. Which gives a pretty good artillery range. And it's a strategic location because of the height, isn't it?
Yes, it's a strategic location, but also from a historical point of view. You know, the Golan Heights, there is no demographic problem there. There are only Jews on the Golan Heights. There are some Druze villages in the north of it, or the Hermon already, but there is clear Jewish majority on the Golan Heights.
But doesn't Israel and keep giving hints to Syria? Yes, we're willing to give you the Golan Heights, if this, if that. Doesn't Israel present an appearance that they're willing to give it up?
The current government, yes.
Even previous governments.
Well, I think that
what government has said, we're keeping it, period, we're not even going to talk about giving it to the Syrians.
No, I agree with you. I am telling you that I think that our position should be, this is part of the state of Israel. We are never pulling down from the Golan Heights. By the way, it is not just the case that it is so essential to Israel and so insignificant to Syria. But even if we pull out from the Golan Heights, we will not get true peace with Syria. This should be clear. And I tell you how I know it. How I know it in advance. I never tried it. I'm looking, and this is the rational thing to do, to Syria relations with all its other neighbors, Arab and Muslim neighbors. Syria have no stable peace with even one other neighbor. Syria was occupying Lebanon until 2 years ago. 1 year ago, they killed the Lebanese resident, a former president Hariri. A few months ago, they killed the Lebanese minister. They are now trying, with the help of Hezbollah, to topple the government there and to recapture Lebanon. This is not true peace. And by the way, there is no Syrian embassy in Beirut because they don't recognize Lebanon independence. With Turkey, just 8 years ago, they were on the verge of total war with the two armed forces on the border already, because Syria was supporting terrorism, especially the PKK group, but also other groups in Turkey. And people ignore it, you know, people are speaking about the Syrian sponsoring terrorism against Israel, but people tend to ignore also the media that for years, and even today, Syria was supporting the Assad regime, was supporting terrorism inside Turkey as well. Jordan, also they were on the verge of fighting across the border in 2000.
Well, Syria has never even pretended to be interested in peace with Israel, have they? I mean,
I'm emphasizing another point. This is a very special regime, even among the dictatorship
even
of the Middle East.
The fellow Arabs, you're saying.
It's not that it cannot get along. This is a Syrian policy to create tension and to sponsor terrorism all around. By the way, also with Iraq, with the former Saddam Hussein regime, there was all the time tension between the two countries. Sometimes there were alliances, sometimes tension, and Syria sent a brigade to support the Americans in the war in Kuwait in 1991. So if you examine Syrian relations with all other neighbors, there is no stable peace between Syria and any other neighbor. So, you know, you should be, it's totally unrealistic to expect that the Jewish state will enjoy true peace, will be the first neighbor to enjoy true peace with Syria.
Let's talk about another area that's very controversial, the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. After the Six-Day War, Israel captured it but gave it back to the Muslims. Now, Jews are barely permitted up there at all. They can pray there. The Muslims are determined to end the Jewish presence there because they know that the Temple Mount is the center of Jewish identity, the holiest site in Judaism. If Jews won't hold on to that, there's nothing they'll hold on to. And so this struggle over this mount is seen as sort of symbolic over what Israel is prepared to do to assert its rights to stay in the land. So how do you think, first let me ask you this, what would you like to see happen on the Temple Mount? Would you like to see it open to Jews so they could go and pray and do what they want? Or do you think it should be kept in Muslims' hands so the Muslims don't get angry and start riots?
No. Let's separate two things. I think that we should not demolish the mosques there, and we should enable Muslims to pray in their mosques. And I think that it was right Israeli policy to ensure, under Israeli sovereignty, a freedom of religion to Christians and Muslims in Jerusalem and elsewhere. Still, this doesn't mean that the Waqf, the Muslim fund, should control not just the mosque, but the entire Temple Mount. I think that they have to conduct the mosques, and of course to enable tourists into the mosque while people are not praying. There is no reason why Jews will not be allowed to tour the mosque. And around the mosque, the Temple Mount, this should be under Israeli sovereignty. And sooner or later, we will have to change the status quo on the Temple Mount. It should be clear that Muslims can conduct their mosque there, but not the entire compound.
So would it be okay if Jews built a little synagogue on top of the Temple Mount and had their prayers there? The Muslims would not accept this.
No, I'm not so confident this either, but what I want to see is that Jews can travel there, can pray there, can go there in large groups, can bring their children there, can make excavations, can travel to all the historical sites over there with no restrictions and limitations. And that Muslim, not sovereignty, but religious autonomy, if you like to call it like this, is restricted to the mosque, not to the entire compound.
Is there a problem with Muslim religious institutions and Jewish religious institutions existing side by side? Because in Islam, as you probably know, I'm sure, there's a belief that Islam is superior to all other religions. They must be supreme, all others are totally subordinate. So, like in Saudi Arabia, for example, it's not even allowed for Jews to set foot inside the country, although they can make exceptions in special cases if they want to. But, and you think you can't have peaceful coexistence side by side, or is one going to have to push the other one out?
I think we can have peaceful coexistence within Israel. And actually we are having some kind of peaceful coexistence with some problems within Israel. On one condition, that we should be strong, and that we shall depict much clearer border lines. What is legitimate, since Israel is democracy, and we have freedom of speech and freedom of religion, and what is a borderline? Supporting terrorism, praising terrorism, supporting the annihilation of Israel, traveling illegally to Syria or to Iran, this is totally illegitimate.
There are Arabs in the Knesset who do those things.
Yeah, so I think we have to punish them. Once we shall punish those who are making illegal, it's clear that according to the Israeli law, it's illegal. We were just too liberal sometimes, or too weak, or both. And you know, in Britain, for example, when one Muslim priest prays terrorism against the West and against Britain, he would put in, he is sitting in jail. I think it should be the same in Israel.
So what's stopping that from happening? I know that much of the political establishment is left-wing, like the Attorney General. Appeasement seems to be...
I became very critical when Azmi Bishara went to Syria a few years ago.
Like the Muslim, the Arab, he's a Christian, isn't he? Not a Muslim, I believe. But he's an Arab Knesset member.
Yes.
Who openly sides with Israel's enemies and calls on them to fight Israel.
Yeah, and not even more than that. He traveled to Syria illegally against the law. Mm-hmm. And because this is an enemy country, we are in a state of war with Syria. And he went to Hezbollah rally in Damascus, in Syria, it was out of Damascus. In this rally, Hezbollah leaders called to the destruction of Israel. And he went on the stage and praised the Hezbollah. I think that this is not just illegal. I think that this is clear betrayal, that this is clear treason. And I think that he should be indicted and put in jail for many years. And if we would take one or two examples, and we treat them as they deserve, other people will understand that they are red lines, also in democracy.
Israel often appears very weak. It lets anybody get away with anything rather than take a firm stand. It almost seems sometimes like it doesn't believe in its own cause. And of course, if you don't believe in your own cause, nobody else is going to believe in your own cause. For example, the standard Arab accusation against Israel is that the Jews stole the land. It's rightfully Arab land, and the Jews stole it, and are now illegally occupying it. And I seldom hear a convincing rebuttal of this from the Israeli government. Their attitude is, well, come on, let's share it. Whereas if Israel were really convinced that the land belonged to it, it wouldn't be talking about sharing it.
Not necessarily. If we are ready to share part of it, it's not because it's not our land, but because there are several million Arab Muslims there that we are unable to expel, and we don't want to integrate into the country because we want to preserve it as a Jewish state. This is the only reason for territorial concessions. This is the deep reason for possible territorial concessions. Right now, I believe there is no place for other concessions. We did the unilateral disengagement from Gaza. We have to hold the, all the territories, Judea and Samaria and the Golan Heights, until at least with regard to the Palestinians, we shall have a reliable partner, and I don't see any reliable partner in the near future.
You refer to the possibility of expelling the Arabs. Is that off the table? Because they openly state that they want to expel the Jews, and Jews have been expelled from many Arab countries. But the Arabs openly say they want to get rid of the Jews, drive them into the sea, kill them, expel them from the land.
Yes, there is no symmetry here.
But is this off the table for Jews to do that to the Arabs?
Let's put it like this. It's off the table in the current situation. In 1948, let's face it, Ben-Gurion ordered the IDF to expel or to encourage Arabs to leave the country, and rightly so. It was an existential war, very difficult war. They were trying to destroy this embryonic state, the Jewish state, so they were expelled from large parts of it. And rightly so, I completely...
Were they forced to leave? I thought that many of them left on their own because they were afraid of what might happen.
Okay, this is also, if you don't let them back, this is also a kind, if you like, of enforcement, yes, not to give people, to let people to go back to their villages and homes. So I'm ready to admit, Ben-Gurion forced Arabs out of Israel when they were trying to destroy the Jewish state and the Jewish people in Israel. And this was justified under those conditions. Today it's...
They're still trying to destroy the Jewish state.
Yes, yes, but we are not in a state today of total war against them, although there is terrorism going on. Today this is totally unrealistic to think about expelling Arabs outside the territories, and there is no party in Israel, not even on the right wing, is demanding it. No political leader in Israel is advocating this. If they will put us back to an existential situation as severe as it was in 1948, I don't know what will be the result. I think they have to be very careful not to push us that far.
It seems like they're trying to push as hard as they can. Every opportunity to push, they seem to be taking it. They use women as suicide bombers, children as suicide bombers, so every Arab woman and child is under suspicion of potentially carrying a bomb. They seem to be working as hard as they can, in my view, to provoke Israel, to force an Israeli response. Could that be because they want to be martyrs? They want Israel to kill them?
Not all of them. Let's face it, not all of them. Here we have to separate. I agree that it's the responsibility of the Palestinian people and the Palestinian leadership, but not all of them are suicide bombers. And here we have also...
But the leadership, what about the leadership?
I think that the leadership is encouraging it. Therefore, I think that we should treat the leadership differently. I think it was the decision that Sharon took the right decision to boycott Arafat and then to put him under siege. I think that we should arrest or kill Hamas leadership today because they are sponsoring terrorism and they are even proud of it. And I think it's totally unacceptable. If they are terrorists, we should treat them as terrorists. Still, we have almost 1 million Muslim Israelis. Most of them are not engaged in terrorism, although some of them are quite hostile to the country, to Israel as a Jewish state. But most of them are not engaged in any illegal terrorist activity, and they should be treated differently.
What's public opinion in Israel now? Do most Israelis think that peace is possible if only Israel makes enough concessions, if only if it gives enough, the Arabs will be satisfied? Or is the position hardening where people are saying they won't be satisfied with anything other than the end of Israel and the death of the Jews, so let's accept that reality and deal with it?
I think that most Israelis realize that this is the case. Unfortunately, it became clear to us that, as I mentioned before, that's the first priority of most Arabs, not all of them, of most Palestinians, is not the establishing of Palestinian homeland, but the destruction of the Jewish homeland. That they are not that interested. This is not at least first priority for them to establish a Palestinian state. They are more interested in harming the Jewish state.
Well,
and this should be clear by now that at least currently, this is the first priority of most of the Palestinian people and most of the Palestinian leaders.
I recall that when the new Hamas legislature had its first meeting, one of the legislators stood up and said that our path is jihad and martyrdom is our greatest wish. He was essentially, he got a standing ovation, by the way. He was saying that they valued martyrdom even more than victory. Their greatest wish was not to win. I mean, benefiting the Palestinians economically wasn't even on the radar screen, apparently.
Yes.
The greatest goal was to die in battle. I mean, it seems like they're literally pinning a sign on themselves and saying, please kill us.
You see, this is exactly the clash of civilization that Professor Huntington was predicting in the early 90s in his famous book on the clash of civilization. Here we are not speaking anymore about territorial disputes. We are speaking about a real clash of civilization between fundamentalist Islam and the free world, and the Western world. They don't care so much about China or India, they care about the Western world. And the conflict, the Israeli-Palestinian or Israeli-Arab conflict, is only part, little part, in this global clash of civilization. I think that the Western world will prevail and Israel will prevail.
We
have to admit, we have to realize that this is not anymore only territorial or national dispute, but it is more than that. And by the way, it's this clash of civilization, and it's bad as it is, with global jihad, with Al-Qaeda, with Hezbollah, with the animosity to Israel, with the animosity to the Western world, with September 11, with the terrible terrorist attacks in Madrid and London and elsewhere. If this clash of civilization will get a nuclear dimension, if the Ayatollahs,
they're trying pretty hard to get nukes.
If the world will allow them to become nuclear, and this clash of civilization will become nuclear, or will get a nuclear dimension, it is going to be terrible, not just to Israel, also to America and to the Western world.
We have very little time left, but speaking about the clash of civilizations, it might seem like a slightly complicated question, but in this clash, what are the key differences between these two civilizations that are so irreconcilable?
Oh, we have here a civilization of fundamentalist Islam that is speaking and thinking in totally different terms. Not in terms of existence, but in terms of, you know, the main task is not to support the Muslim people of the Muslim world, but to harm Israel in the West, to destroy the West if possible, to destroy the Western culture. This is the goal. Not so much in order for Muslims to be benefited, but because this is an holy, some kind of an holy goal or an holy task. And to achieve, yes, truly, in the end, to achieve Muslim hegemony or dominance in the Western world, in Europe, and later on maybe elsewhere, in America and elsewhere.
I think we're going to have to wrap.